Greetings. I'm glad we are together. Again, I hope you can hear me. I'm going to talk about a subject that it is pretty simple, yet very complicated. We, so many times, we desire more results. We desire more power. We desire more growth. We wonder what has happened to the miracles from the Bible. We remember how God has split the Red Sea. Imagine if you if you were there. If you are there and you see the Red Sea split in two and see two vertical walls of water standing, that's quite a miracle. We wonder what happened to the miracles of the resurrection, resurrection of Tabitha, resurrection of Lazarus. What happened to the miracles of all the wonderful things in the Bible? I could go on and on and on. Jonah eaten by the fish and then spit by the fish. And this is quite something. Why don't they happen today? Not that we should look for miracles. We should look for God. But we don't sense the same power. We go to church, we come back home, and many times nothing happens. And in our life, we pray, we study, and not much happens. And the spirit of prophecy is very clear. In the book of Acts, Acts of the Apostles, also in Desire of Ages towards the end, it says that God wants us to be faithful in small things. Don't wait for miracles. Don't wait for big things. Be faithful and be committed and be totally dedicated in small things daily, things that don't seem so important. And as you are faithful in those things, don't wait for big things. Don't look for big things. As you are faithful in small things, those prepare you for bigger things. And as you are faithful in those prepare you for more things. And this is how God prepares you for his plan. And then she talks about Moses, that it took him 40 long years. 40 years, it's a life. If you were him, I don't know if you would have the patience to wait 40 years. 40 years to prepare him for his work. Think about all the others. Joseph, 10 years a slave, 7 years in prison, altogether 17 years until God really used him. And he didn't know the end of the story. If you know the end of the story, it's easy to wait. But if you don't know what's going to happen, if it will ever happen, do you continue to trust in God? They didn't trust in God because something happened. They trusted in God because they knew God. They didn't know anything, a miracle or an answer or a voice. They knew God, and that was enough for them. That took a lot of commitment. The Bible says, give me one person that is fully committed to the whole heart, and I can save a whole nation. God is looking for 100% commitment. God is looking for 100% dedication. People in the Bible, people of faith, they have been committed regardless suffering, regardless circumstances. They have been 100% committed. Abraham left his country, left everything. He went in the wilderness. He didn't know what's going to happen and when. Daniel was taken from his family. His family was killed in the war. He was taken and he was a slave in Babylon. He didn't know that he would be prime minister. He didn't know what was going to happen, but he was fully committed. We could go on and on with the examples. I'm going to give you a story and then we start our subject. God expects absolute, total, full commitment. People with 95% commitment are going to burn in the fire and die eternal death together with people with zero commitment. God cannot take 95 or 99, as a matter of fact, commitment. If you imagine that God takes 95 and you keep 5, whatever you keep, it's actually Satan's. It belongs to Satan. You cannot say I am neutral. I give God 95% and 5% I don't give to Satan. I keep it for myself. God says, whoever is not with me is actually against me. Whatever you don't give it to God, it's not that you keep it for yourself. That's what Satan wants. That means you follow Satan. You give it to Satan. And so either all or nothing. You cannot be a 99% Christian. 1% that you don't commit. 1% that you don't surrender. That's what chokes your relationship with God. That's what limits God's power in our life. That's the reason God cannot work today as he has worked in the past. God has never changed. God is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. God has not lost his power. He is old. He can hardly walk. He says, oh, I would love to help you, but I am sick. God has not changed. The reason God cannot work today is because we don't commit today as they have committed in the past. We are afraid to commit. What's going to happen to me? And we are afraid to commit because we don't trust God that he will take care of us. And we don't trust him because we don't know him. And we don't know him because we don't spend time with him. Many times we say we are Christians. We go to church. But we actually, while we think that we love God, we have other priorities. And whatever is your priority, that's your God. That's what you worship. And so, if you commit only 96%, 4% belongs to Satan. That means that God and Satan must live together in your heart. God has four rooms and Satan has one little room. God and Satan don't live together in the same apartment. When God comes in, Satan goes out. You cannot have both, either God or Satan. And you say, well, I don't serve Satan. I just have some things that are personal. Well, when you serve self, you serve Satan. And so God is looking for full commitment. Remember the rich young ruler says, I've kept the commandments. That's what we do. I've kept the commandments. And Jesus says, that's good. You should do this and don't leave the other things undone. That's good. Wonderful. I've been going to church. That's good. You should go to church. I keep Sabbath. Yes, that's one of the Ten Commandments. Sure, it's good. I know the prophecies. That's wonderful. I know the Bible. That's good. Pharisees did know the Bible. They did keep the Sabbath. They did go to temple. And Jesus said to the rich young ruler, sell how much? Everything. Give up. Surrender. Everything. 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 100%. All. And he turned around sad because he was not willing to really surrender all. He left. He turned his back to Jesus. It's good to keep the commandments. It's good to go to church. It's good to know the doctrines. But it's not enough. Pharisees did that too. If you don't surrender all, you cannot be a Christian. Jesus very simply says, whoever doesn't hate mother and father and sister and brother and self, his own life, cannot be my disciple. In the Greek, the word hate there is micheo. Micheo doesn't mean in translation to hate. Micheo means to love less than. Or another translation, the love for this compared to the love for that is so small compared to that. That is so big that this one seems like hate. Basically, if you translate, the love for anything else, for mother, father, for job, for your house, for yourself, the love for those things compared to the love for God, the love for God is so big that the love for those things seems like hate. Or, in a different translation, to love less than, to love those things. Not necessarily to hate your mother and your father, because in the fifth commandment, God told you to love and respect them and honor them. In the Bible, God is telling us to love people, not to hate people, love one another, to love even our enemies. In 1 John chapter 4, he says that if you don't love people, if you say that you love God, you are a liar. God is teaching us to love people. But the verse says, unless you hate the other things, translated means, unless you love the other things less than you love God, you are not a disciple. You may think you are a Christian, but you are not. Whatever you love more than God, that's your God. That's what you worship. And so, let me give you an example. When we talk about surrendering all, Paul the Apostle says, I consider, listen carefully, I consider how many things? All things means 90%, 95, 98. What does he mean, all? All means all. Job, anything, absolutely all. I consider all things a loss. And he repeats three times in that paragraph, I consider all things a loss for the price of knowing Jesus Christ, my Savior. And I consider all things a loss. And then he says again, all things a loss. And then he repeats a fourth time, and I consider them garbage. The term in Greek is kubalo, that means animal excrements. I consider them garbage for the price of having Jesus Christ. Basically, what he says, I consider all things garbage for the price of getting more of Jesus. Basically, the more you eliminate other things from your heart, the more you may room for Jesus. And to the degree that you surrender the other things, to that degree, to that extent, God can come in your heart. And so if you surrender all, God can fill you all with his presence. The reason we have no power is that we have a theory of religion, a theory of God, but not necessarily the presence of God, because we don't surrender all things. Therefore, God cannot come all into our heart. So God is not happy with a corner. Either he is in or he is out. We have a very strange relationship. We keep him at the door and we like to talk to him. Please don't leave, stay there. But we don't fully want him inside. And so Paul says, I consider all things. He says, I die daily. I die daily. In fact, he says in Galatians, I've been crucified and I no longer live, I am dead. Dead people are dead. Let me explain. Dead people don't talk. Dead people don't desire. Dead people don't have a will. They are dead. They know nothing. He says, I am dead. I don't need anything. I don't know anything. I don't want anything. Dead people don't fight. Dead people don't argue. If you argue with somebody, it means you are alive. He says, I am dead. I no longer live. Christ lives in me. And the life that I live in faith in him. I trust in him. I let him, his will is my will. What he says, that's what I say. What he does is what I do. My will is immersed, is confused in his will. I live for him. Isn't that wonderful? Oh, what happens to me if I do that? He says, I live in faith. I trust God. I've been crucified. I no longer live. I'm dead. Jesus talking about dying, he says, if a grain stays alive, he will never produce anything. But if a grain would die, then he will produce much fruit. It seems to me that the reason we have no results, no power, is because we are very much alive. It's easier to keep Sabbath. It's easier to go to church. It's easier to sing Kumbaya. It's easier to return tithe. It's easier not to work on Sabbath, you know. It's difficult to work. To be lazy is very easy. It's easier to do all these things, but it's a lot more difficult to fully surrender. We do sing the song, all to Jesus. It's easy to sing the song. Say it again, sing the song. But it's very difficult to fully surrender. And the reason we have no power is because we don't surrender. Our lack of surrender, our lack of commitment, limits God's power, God's work in our life and through our life. Our lack of surrender is what chokes our relationship with God and God's power in our life and results in our life and in our churches. God is able to work with power that would surpass any type of human imagination. But he cannot work because we limit him, because we don't trust him enough to fully surrender. In fact, Jesus clearly talks about it. I want to jump quick to a Bible verse. Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also." In fact, Jesus says, he will do greater works than me in John chapter 14. Greater works than me. Wow. The spirit of prophecy says that the work is going to close with greater manifestation of power than it started. Where are those works? Is Jesus lying? Is the Bible lying when he says you will do greater works? If you analyze the first century church, they had no power. They tried to resurrect this and to heal that and to cast the demons from this. And they came to Jesus, oh, we have no power. And Jesus did those things. But after the upper room, after they prayed and surrendered all, and they helped one another, and they forgot self, they received power. And they, God worked through them. Amazing, powerful miracles and results after they fully surrendered. I could go on and explain and give Bible verses. Let me give you a few quotations. A few quotations, and then we actually start. Let me share the screen here. Okay. The Savior's promise to his disciples, when he said, you'll do greater works, that's the promise that he's referring to. The Savior promised to his disciples, it's a promise to his church at the end of time. Who is his church at the end of time? He's talking about you and me. We are the church at the end of time. The Savior promised to his disciples, it's a promise to his church, the church at the end of time. I want you to think about that. God did not design that his wonderful plan to redeem man should achieve only small, insignificant results. All who will go to work, trusting not in what they can do, but in what God can do, will certainly realize the fulfillment of his promise. Greater works you shall do. Isaiah, page 667. Let's read another quotation. Christ came to heal the sick, to proclaim deliverance to the captives. The gospel still possesses the same power. Then why should we not today witness the same results? Isaiah 8:2-3. Through the gift of the Holy Spirit, the disciples were to receive marvelous power. Their testimony was to be confirmed by signs and wonders. Miracles were to be brought. Isaiah 8:2-2. Through the gift of the Holy Spirit, the disciples were to receive marvelous power. They were supposed to receive the same power. The same power. Listen carefully. The same power that Jesus had. Where is that power? The gospel is still to be presented not as a lifeless, powerless, cold theory, but as a living force that will change the life. God desires that the receivers of grace shall witness its power. Isaiah 8:2-6. Where is that power? Where is that power? I could give you more quotations and more Bible verses. We seem to lack that power. We desire to see results. Where are those results? Well, let me give you a story. Many years ago, I was in the army. I was a lieutenant, and I was in a unit, a garrison, that had a small unit called Genius. It's not that the soldiers or Genius or anything like that. It's just that they were a group of soldiers selected. All of us with higher education, and they were supposed not to do one thing, like infantry, like artillery, like not supposed to do one thing, but you're supposed to know everything and be able to do everything. You're supposed to know to shoot any type of weapon and to drive any type of machine. And you're supposed to know to make any type of bomb from a small one that you put in a pencil or a telephone to a big one that you can blow a bridge or a mountain, in fact. You're supposed to know everything. And when the army could not go in one place, it was too dangerous. They would send one person from the genius unit, and that person would be able to stop the enemy planting a bomb or doing something. So I was in this unit called Genius. And the lieutenant came, not the lieutenant, actually, the captain came to me and he said, Goya, you are the enemy. I said, me, the enemy? What do you mean? You are the enemy of the state. I said, me, the enemy? Why would you say that? You are dangerous. Me? I'm not dangerous. Look at me. He says, yes, you are an Adventist and therefore you are dangerous. In this country, we don't believe in God. In this country, if you believe in God, you are dangerous. I said, no. I love my country. My Bible teaches me to pray for the government, to pray for the place where you live, to pray for the country, to pray for the leaders. I love my country. I am praying for my country. I am serving my country. He says, yeah, but you don't work on your Sabbath, your Saturday. I said, that's okay. I don't work on Sabbath, but I work every other day. Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, every day I work. Well, if it was an emergency, if we were in the war, if I was shot, would you save me on Saturday? I said, absolutely. If it was an emergency, I would save your life. Any day, Saturday or Monday. Doesn't matter, it's Sabbath. I would save your life. Well, if I ask you to work on Sabbath and build a house, would you do it? I said, no, that's not an emergency. That's not saving anybody's life. That's not an emergency. Why would I do it? I can do it during the week. You see, you are dangerous. I said, no, that's not dangerous. I said, you don't work on Sunday. You take off on Sunday. Well, if it was an emergency, I would come. Me too. If it was an emergency, I would come on Sabbath. And I said, it's not that I come to do any type of work, but if it's about saving your life, absolutely I come. He said, no. You put God above us. I said, you are right there. God comes first. Well, that's what makes you dangerous. I said, no. That's what makes me actually different and better. Because if I put God first, not self, I am not selfish. I forget self. And God doesn't teach me to hate people. God teaches me to love people and to save people. And God teaches me to love my country. And if I obey God, that makes me actually better, not dangerous. People that are selfish, self-centered are dangerous. He said, now you need to put our regime above your God. And you need to give up your Sabbath. I said, I cannot do that. Well, you cannot be with God and with us. I said, no, I am fully with God. He said, well, that makes you dangerous. And he said, I'm going to teach you a lesson. In our country, there is no God. I want to see what God can save you from my hands. We have the power. Well, he told me, during peace, if you don't execute my order, if you don't obey my order, between you and me, it's 2 to 5 years prison. But if you don't obey my order in front of the other soldiers, you undermine my authority, it's 7 to 14 years prison. And during war, we execute you on the spot, we shoot you on the spot. And he called, it was Saturday morning, he called the other soldiers. We were all together, 51. In that group, in the genius group, we were all together, 51. In the whole garrison, in the whole building, over 5,000 soldiers. But in that specific group, there were 51. He called the other 50. And he ordered them to get straight, to align themselves. They all got straight. They saluted him. And then he said, repose, relax. And they relaxed. And then he ordered me to make 3 steps forward. I took 3 steps forward. I saluted him and I took the straight position. And then he said, it's Saturday morning. Goya, I give you an order, a direct command. I want you to dig a hole. I said, why would I dig a hole? Don't you argue with me. It's a command. You say, yes, sir. And you dig the hole. I said, with all due respect, Captain, but I cannot dig the hole because it's my Sabbath. I don't work in Sabbath. Oh, he got so angry. You disregard my authority in front of the other soldiers. You don't obey a direct command. He got red. He started to stutter. He could not even speak. When he would speak, he started to spit and to foam and really angry and red. I thought he would have a heart attack. He said, I'm going to teach you a lesson. Nobody disobey my command. I'm going to destroy your life. I'm going to terminate you. I'm going to terminate you. Nobody can save you. No God. Where is God? I want to see him. And he lifted his fist towards heaven. He looked up and he really, using very bad, dirty words, he cursed God. And then he said, where are you? I want to see you. And I said, I'm so glad my God is patient, because if you would obey you and come, you would die instantaneously. You are crazy. There is no God. I'm going to destroy your life, and I want to see what God can save you from my hands. I said to him, I remember then the three young men that the king of Babylon told them to worship the image. And he said, no God can save you from my hand. And I said to him, like they did, if God wants to save me, they said that, if God wants to save us, he has the power. If not, we'll not worship the image. If God wants to save me, he has the power. If not, I will not work on Sabbath. Why don't you just work on Sabbath? And I don't care what you think. You can worship your God in your mind. I said, either all with God or all against God. I cannot just compromise. God is looking for full commitment. Well, he said, there is no God. You are crazy. And he said, I want you to dig a hole in the ground. I said, why would I do that? I want you to imagine that there is war. I want you to imagine that the enemy airplanes are flying above and they are attacking you and they are shooting at you, and you need to dig a hole and hide. You need to mask you. You need to hide. You need, you know. I looked up. I said, I don't see any enemy airplanes. I don't need to dig a hole. They are not attacking me. There is no enemy airplanes above me. Why would I dig a hole? Well, I want you to imagine that there is enemy airplanes. I said, well, Captain, then I want you to imagine that I dug the hole. Oh, he got so angry. Are you mocking me? He started to curse and he said, this is it. I'm done with you. He turned around. He left all the soldiers in the training field. He went back to the garrison, to the unit. He called all the officers, over 5,000 soldiers. He had an emergency meeting. And in that meeting, he proposed maximum prison for me, 14 years, in the toughest facility. It was in a town called Caracal, in the toughest facility for military prisoners in the country. He proposed that I would be put in the toughest prison, maximum sentence. And he said to me, I'm going to put you in the toughest prison in the country. I'm going to put you there 14 years. And there they would command you to break Sabbath. And if you don't, they are going to double your sentence, and they are triple your sentence. And you'll spend your life in prison until you give up your God. And there will be no God to save you from that place. He left. And so the soldiers dispersed. They looked to me with fear. Whoa, we are so sorry for you, Pavel. I went back to the garrison. I went to the warehouse. I locked myself inside that room, the warehouse. I was in charge of the warehouse where all the supplies were, all the shoes, all the boots, all the blouses, all the shovels, all the weapons, all the compasses, all the tools that we used. I locked myself inside the warehouse and I did like every good Adventist would do. I prayed. And guess what I prayed? Lord, please save me. Save my freedom, Lord. I really don't want to go to prison. I cannot imagine if I go to prison 14 years, how they will beat me and torture me and abuse me. I don't want to go to prison. Please, Lord. And I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I prayed and I got no peace and no answer and no comfort. I want you to think about it. Jesus says, who love his life is going to lose it. and who is willing to lose his life is going to save it. Basically, whatever you love and you want to keep and you want to preserve, you lose it. And whatever you surrender, give up, give it to God, that's what you save. Whatever you really want to keep and you are not willing to surrender, that's what you worship. Whatever you are not able to give it to God, that's what you love more than God. It came in my mind what my father told me one time. If you really want to be a Christian, it's not enough to go to church. It's good, but not enough. You need to fully surrender your life, your freedom, your money, your time, your energy, your gifts, your whole thing, your being. You need to surrender your life. And if you are not able to surrender something, whatever that may be, something, your children or your job or your health, if you are your freedom, if you are not willing to surrender something, that stops God from working in your life. Whoa. So while I was praying, Lord, save me, I was focusing on me, my freedom, save me, my freedom, I don't want to go to prison. It came in my mind, whoever doesn't hate everything, including his life, his freedom, is not my disciple. And I remember that people in the Bible have surrendered everything. Abraham, he has surrendered everything, including his son. God asked him to sacrifice his son. He was willing to put God above his own son. Moses, he was supposed to be the Pharaoh of Egypt. He surrendered everything. And I felt strongly impressed to give up my life and my freedom. I remember what John the Baptist said, he shall increase and I shall decrease. I remember what Paul said, I consider all things garbage. For me to live is Christ, I live for him. And to die, it's a favor, it's a privilege. It's going to be a second to resurrection. I'm going to see Jesus face to face. For me, my life is not important. Christ is important. For me, I don't come first. Jesus comes first. And so I changed my prayer. I stopped praying, Lord, please, please, please save me from prison. Save me, deliver me, protect me. And I said, Lord, I'm not going to pray for me. My father used to tell me, we pray the wrong prayer. We pray for job. We pray for health. That's okay. That's okay to ask God for help in your life. That's okay to present your needs, to cast your needs upon him. But it's not okay to make those needs a priority. You should make God a priority. And then after that, present those needs. Listen carefully. My father would say to me, seek first God and his kingdom and his righteousness. And the other things God promised will be provided. If you seek other things first, you actually worship other things. So in my prayer, in that warehouse, I changed my prayer. And instead of putting me first, I put God first. And I said, Lord, sure, I don't want to go to prison, but I am willing to surrender my freedom and my life. And I'm not going to pray for myself. I'm not going to put myself and my freedom first. I'm going to put you and your kingdom and your honor and your righteousness first. So, Lord, do to me whatever would honor you. If Joseph, it came in my mind, if Joseph didn't go to prison, he would have never been prime minister of Egypt. If Daniel didn't go to Babylon as a slave, he would have never been prime minister of Babylon. Not that I wanted to be prime minister of Romania. But if those people didn't accept God's plan in faith, God could have never used them. We say we want to obey God, but we actually tell God what to do, how to do it, when to do it, and we are not willing to trust in him, in his plan. If we knew the end from the beginning, we would actually trust him and choose the same path. And so, instead of praying for me and putting myself first, my freedom first, I surrendered my freedom and I put God first, his plan, his will, his honor. And I prayed different prayer. I said, Lord, I surrender my freedom. I surrender my life. Do to me, not what I want. Sure, I want freedom. Sure, I don't want to go to prison. But Lord, I'm going to trust in you. Do to me whatever would honor you. Jesus would have come on this earth and would have died for one person. If you have one person that needs to be saved in prison, Jesus would have died for that. Shouldn't I be willing to go to prison if one person could be in heaven? If you have one person in prison that needs salvation, let me go to prison. If you have some plan that I don't understand, I'm willing to surrender my freedom. Do to me not what I want, but whatever would serve you, would honor you, would serve your kingdom, would save people, whatever would honor you. Do to me whatever you want. But Lord, I am praying that whatever you do to me, that's not important. My life, my freedom is not important. You are important. I'm going to forget self and put you first. But do to me whatever would show these people that there is a God in heaven, that they would know that there is a God, and they would know you, and they would trust in you, and they would have a chance to be saved. And so instead of praying for myself, I forgot myself. And I put God and his honor and his plan first at any price, including the price of my freedom. When I prayed that prayer, it was a difficult prayer to pray, to give God permission to do whatever. That's pretty hard. When I prayed that prayer, I instantly had peace in my heart. I instantly had comfort. I knew that God is right there. I heard the voice saying in my mind, if you go through waters, not if you, it says when, you will go through waters. It's just a matter of time. But the Bible says, when you go through waters, I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. I love you. I have inscribed you on my palms. I will never leave you. Even if a mother will forget her children, I will never forget you. God told me, don't worry. He didn't tell me what was going to happen next, but he told me, don't worry. I am here. You are not alone. I am with you. And I remember then that God was with the three young men in the fiery furnace. God, literally, God came there physically and God walked with them through the fire. He said to me, don't worry. I am with you. And I started to sing. In that moment, somebody knocked in the door of the warehouse. I opened the door. It was a sergeant. His name was Marian. He said, Pavel? I said, okay. You are a Christian, yes. You cannot lie. I said, yes. You need to tell the truth. I said, yeah. I want you to tell me, do you know General Joanna? I said, who? General Joanna. I said, no. Oh, please don't lie. You know him. You are friends. You are relatives. I said, man, I don't know who are you talking about. I don't know him. I never heard this name before in my life. You don't know him? Nope. Who is him? Oh, all the armies in Romania, in every city, all the armies are divided in four groups, in north, in south, east, and west. And all the country, all the armies, all the units are divided in four. And they are called army number one, number two, number three, number four. And there are four generals that they are the leaders of the four armies of Romania. And they are under the president, under Ceausescu. And these four generals are fearful people. Everybody is afraid of them. They have a lot of power. These four generals, they are the most powerful people in our country. Well, General Joanna is the general of army number three. And Goya, we are in a meeting, in an emergency meeting to put you in prison. It was proposed that we put you 14 years in prison. And the door opened. And guess who showed up? General Joanna. I mean, he lives in Bucharest, in the capital of the country. And we are here in this town, 500 kilometers away. And he showed up unannounced here with his guards. When he came in, we all stood straight and we were shaking in fear. Whoa, this is bad news. When he shows up, something is wrong. Something is going to happen. We can lose our jobs. And we are all afraid, waiting to see why is he here. And he said, I came here to inspect the unit 2 years ago, and it was a mess. I came here today again to inspect the unit to see if it's better. And he says, I like what I see. The fence was broken. Right now, the fence is nice and new. You told me last time that you don't have money. You don't have the budget. You don't have the funds to fix the fence. Who fixed the fence for you? And they said, well, there is a soldier called Goya, Pavel, he fixed the fence. Well, how much did you pay him? Oh, nothing, he volunteered. Oh, wonderful. Last time the roof was leaking, but right now the roof is new. Who fixed the roof for you? Well, Goya, he worked roofs with his father. He knows how to do roofs. He fixed the roof. Oh, wonderful. How much did you pay him? Oh, nothing. He volunteered to help us. Well, last time the driveway was broken. Right now it's new. Who fixed the driveway? Oh, Goya. Well, he knows driveways too. Oh, yeah, he worked with his father almost anything. He fixed the driveway. For free? Yeah, for free. Oh, what a good soldier. I wish everybody was like him. And I noticed that the museum was dirty and broken. Right now it's all covered in glass, beautiful. Who fixed the museum? Oh, Goya has a diamond. He knows how to cut glass. He worked with his father. He knows to do almost anything. How much did you pay him? Oh, nothing. Every day after the instruction, after the training, when soldiers go to rest, he would walk around, and if he sees something broken, he would fix it for free because he wants to help. Oh, that's a wonderful soldier. You what have you done to reward him? What have you done to reward him? Did you pay him? No. Did you send him home, give him a week vacation at home with his family? No. Did you make a picture by the Romanian flag and put it as an example in front of all 5,000 soldiers and officers to say everybody should be like him? Did you put a picture with him? No. Well, why not? He's the best one that you have. Okay, why are you here in a meeting? Oh, we want to put a soldier in prison. Who? Well, Goya. The same guy? Yeah. Why would you do that? He refused to dig a hole today. What? He refused to dig a hole in the ground. Why would you ask him to dig a hole? We told him to imagine that there is war. But there is no war. Why would you ask him to dig a hole? Well, to prove that he is a Christian. Is he against the government? He is not against the government. He says he is praying for the government. Then why would you ask him to dig a hole? Well, he doesn't work on Saturdays. Well, does he work in the other days? Oh, yeah. Do the other soldiers work? Oh, no, they are lazy. They are drunk always. Then leave him alone. Why would you ask him to dig a hole? Well, we told him that there is war, but there is no war. You leave him alone. If you touch this soldier, you are going to lose your jobs. I myself, I will make sure that you lose your jobs. Don't you touch him. You touch him, you touch me. I want you to leave him alone. And then the sergeant looked to me and said, Pavel, do you know General Joanna? Are you friends? Are you relatives? I said, I don't know him. I know somebody bigger. He said, wow. He probably thought I know the president of the country. I was referring to God. After that, a different captain came, Bărbulescu. He told me the same story. Do you know General Joanna? I said, no. Oh, this is what he said, that we should not touch you. We should leave you alone. From that day on, for the rest of the military service, for the rest of the military period, nobody touched me. Officers would walk by me and they would salute me and say, Goya, you can do whatever you want. You can keep your Sabbath. You can pray. You can go to church. Just please call General Joanna and tell him that we take good care of you. Maybe if you tell them that, maybe we get a promotion. I said, I don't know him. Oh, we know you know somebody bigger. If you honor God, he will honor you. If you put him first, he will put you first. If you make him a priority, he will make you a priority. But God cannot work as long as we put self first and our interest. God cannot work before we fully surrender. Before we love him more than ourselves, our lives, our freedoms, our jobs, our families, our anything. Our lack of surrender limits God's power and work in our lives. Think about it. All people of faith in the Bible have fully surrendered. Moses surrendered everything. Abraham surrendered everything. Joseph, Daniel, you name it. All of them. Paul, he had a brilliant future. Paul was educated by the teacher called Gamaliel. He had a brilliant future. He was influential among Pharisees and Sadducees and teachers of the law. Yet Paul surrendered all He says, I consider all things garbage. The reason God has worked in the lives of those people is because they have surrendered all. Peter says, Jesus, we have surrendered everything. And Jesus says to Peter, you'll get back 100 times in this life plus eternal life. The rich young ruler was not willing to surrender and he lost it all. I want you to think about it. Take an example. Peter is fishing. Just a small, simple example. Peter is fishing with his friends, with his colleagues, with his fishermen. They are not amateurs. They are professional fishermen. They have experience. He has been a fisherman all his life. He has years and years and years and years of experience. He knows how to fish. He and his parents and his grandparents from generation to generation have been in fishing business. He lives, that's his salary. And if you know anything about fishing, you don't go fishing at noon. You go in the night early, 4, 5 a.m. You don't go fishing in small water. You go fishing in the deep. In small water, only small fish stay. Big fish are smart. They stay in the deep. Peter and his colleagues have tried to fish the whole night in the best possible spots, and they caught nothing. They caught nothing. I want you to remember, the Bible says that we need to surrender all. The Bible says, I honor those who honor me. You need to put God first. And Peter tried to fish and he caught nothing, nothing, zero. Peter comes back tired, broken, discouraged. No fish, no results, nothing. He comes back in the morning, the sun is up, he's tired, he's broken. He comes back to the shore. And when he's close to the shore, Jesus says, good morning, Peter. Have you caught anything? He says, no, it was a bad night. Zero, not even one fish, not even a small one. Jesus says, nothing. And Jesus says to him, throw the net in the right side. Now I want you to think about it. Jesus was talking to him. If Peter was far where the water is deep, Jesus could not have talked to him. Jesus would have to scream, Peter, huh? Peter, can you hear me? There is wind, there are waves, it's too far, wait until I come. Jesus was not screaming. Jesus was talking to him. That means he was pretty close. If you go there in at that lake, the closer you get to the shore, the smaller the water it is. If they could talk face to face, that means that the water was quite shallow, small, not deep. There is no fish in small water. Except very little fish. Jesus says, throw the net in the right side. But the right side was toward Jesus, toward the shore. The water even smaller in that side of the boat. Peter says, probably, Jesus, I've tried the whole night. I've been in the best times, in the best spots, in the deep, and I caught nothing. Please, don't teach me about fishing. You can teach me about spiritual life, but I can teach you about fishing. I'm a fisherman. Please, Lord, don't make me throw the net here. It's 11 a.m. The sun is up. The water is small. Don't embarrass me in front of my colleagues, in front of my buddies. They will make fun. Have you lost your mind? You throw the net here? Come on. Jesus says, Peter, trust and obey. There is no other way. Throw the net. So, okay, Lord, if you say so, but I tell you, I warn you, there is no fish. And Peter threw the net. And there was so much, so much, so much fish that the net started to break. So Peter whistled and called all the other fishermen with the other boats. And they all came and they all threw the nets to help his net. And their net started to break. And they caught so much fish that they put the fish in the boats. And it was not 1 or 2 or 10 kilograms. It was like a mountain of fish in the boats, like a pyramid, like a hill. So much fish that the boats started to sink. They have never, never in their lifetime, never in history, they have never seen so much fish. That's a miracle. They, wow, where is this fish coming from? And Jesus said to Peter something pretty strange. Give up the fish, and I will make you fisher of men. And that's a conditional in Greek, in the translation. You cannot be fisher of men. You cannot be with both, with the fish and with the ministry. You cannot serve both. You need to give this one up in order to make room for the other one. Give up the fish. Leave the fish. And I will make you fisher of men. Think about it. There is no logic there. Why would you give me the fish? Because you, Jesus, gave me the fish. And then you ask me to surrender it. If I am hungry, if I didn't eat for 4, 5, 6 days, you come and you show me food. You show me food. And then you say, give up the food. Why would you show me the food if you want me to give up the food? Jesus, why would you give me the fish and then ask me to give it up? Well, I'm going to tell you why. I see only two reasons. Jesus wanted to teach Peter two lessons. Lesson number one, you cannot serve me. You cannot be successful. You cannot have results. You cannot have blessings and power before you are willing to surrender it all. Either you are with the world or with me. Who is not with me is against me. You cannot be half divided. Your heart cannot be divided and expect growth and victory and results. To the degree that you surrender, to that degree, I can come in your heart and I can work in you and through you. In order for me to come in, you need to surrender all. Jesus wanted to teach Peter to surrender all. But lesson number two, Jesus wanted to say, who gave you the fish? I did it. Don't you think that if I had the power to give you the fish today, I can give you the fish tomorrow? If I send the word and the fish jumped into your net, don't you think that I can do that tomorrow? I say, let there be light, and there is light. I say to the sea, be still, and it's still. I say to the fish, jump in the net, and they do. Trust me, surrender all. And as I gave you the fish today, I'll give you the fish tomorrow. Seek me and my kingdom and my righteousness first, and I will provide the other things. Trust in me. I take care of the flowers, I can take care of you. Jesus wanted to teach Peter, number one, to surrender all. And number two, to trust in God's power, in God's love, in God's promise. And because Peter was willing, Peter could have said, Lord, come on, if we sell this fish, we give 50, not 10, 50% to the church. And the other 50 we put in the bank, you know, there will be tough days ahead. We have a reserve. Jesus said, nope, all or nothing, surrender all. And then follow me. That was the reason Peter, because he surrendered all, that was the reason Peter would walk. And his shadow would go over sick people. And sick people would be instantly healed. That was the reason Peter went to Tabitha. She was dead. He prayed over her and the dead came back to life because Peter surrendered all. And I could give you more examples. Elisha, when Elijah came, Elisha surrendered his business, his farm. He surrendered all. That was the reason God worked through them. And I could go on and on. All people of faith in the Bible have surrendered all. And that's the reason God could work with power in their life. We need to finish. Our time is up. But the reason God has no power to work in our lives is because we are afraid to surrender all. Let me share some quotations with you about surrendering and about power. Again, the reason we have no power, the reason we have no results is because we don't fully surrender. To the degree that you surrender, to that degree God will be able to work. Let me give you a few quotations and then we finish. To everyone. Everyone means everyone, regardless age, regardless who you are. to everyone who offered himself to God for service, withholding nothing. That word, withholding nothing, means absolute, full, complete surrender, withholding nothing. To everyone who offered himself to God, for withholding nothing for self, full surrender, is given unlimited heavenly power for attainment of measureless results. Can you grasp the meaning of unlimited heavenly power? Let me give you another quotation. Many who profess to be Christians have an anxious, troubled heart because they are afraid to trust God. They don't make a complete surrender because they shrink from the consequences of that surrender. Unless they will fully surrender, they will never have peace. God will do great things for those who trust in him. The reason his professed people have no greater power is because they trust too much in their own wisdom and don't give the Lord an opportunity to reveal his power. He will help his children in every emergency if they place their entire confidence in him. Our Heavenly Father has 1,000 ways to provide for us, ways that we know nothing of. Now listen carefully. Those who accept this one principle, how many principles? I want you to understand, it's only one principle. And what is that principle? To make God's service supreme, to make God's service supreme, to put God first, supreme, above anything else. Those who accept this only one principle, to put God first, to make him supreme, to put his service first, they will find perplexity vanish in front of their feet. There are more paragraphs, we don't have time. I also had a story to finish with, a powerful story of surrender and how God works powerfully. We don't have time, maybe tomorrow, but God is calling you and me today more than any time before to full surrender. Jesus is coming. There is no more time to have a divided heart. There is no more time to be with God and with self. That means with Satan. There is no more God, no more time to have a divided heart. God is calling you to absolute total commitment, absolute total commitment, full commitment, full surrender. God is calling you not only to sing, but to practically live the song. All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I fully give. Jesus is coming soon. If we don't learn to surrender all, we will not be with him in heaven. He will not take a divided heart. But if you surrender, you may not know what's going to happen. You may be afraid, what's going to happen to me? But as soon as you make a decision, you step out in faith and you decide to trust in him, you'll give him an opportunity to work and you'll experience him. He may not answer in the time you want, in the way you want, but if you wait upon him, you'll experience his power and his love. Taste and see how good God is. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you so much that you invite us to fully trust in you, in order to fully experience you. Please help us to surrender. As the spirit of prophecy says that the prayer of the soul, the prayer of the soul should daily be, I put myself in your hands. I surrender all today. Work according to your will. Our prayer should be not only one time, but every day. Lord, I surrender today. I surrender myself, my family, my life, my time, my energy, my everything. I surrender all to you. Please lead me according to your will. Father, we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.